Good morning. A warm welcome to all of you here this morning joining us in person and online. And a special welcome to friends of the congregation and to those of you who are joining us for the first time. This morning, I'm not who you expect to see up here. Our pastor Ann became unwell this morning suddenly and she's unable to be here, so I'll be taking over. That means that we will not have communion today, but luckily, affirmation of baptism is not a sacrament that I cannot do, so we will continue with that as planned. If you are new here or not, we have these friendship pads, and we would love for you to fill them out for us today with all of your information. That way we can get in touch with you if you desire that. Today, after worship, we will have a recap of the Synod Assembly, and luckily Matt, who's up in the sound booth today, he is going to be leading that for us today. Richard. So while he's getting up here, next week we will celebrate Pentecost, so I invite all of you to wear red.
Good morning. Next week, next Sunday, is when we take babies, the diapers and the whites for the Baby Steps program over to St. Michael's. So we have a wagon full now. We're gonna have two more wagons if we need them. So if you do, I wanna thank everybody that did bring either the baby wipes or the diapers. But if you still want to bring some wipes or diapers, please do so before Sunday morning here. Thank you very much.
In the name of the risen Messiah, Jesus, and the Creator of all, and of the Spirit who breathes new life, we gather together in a world troubled by varied expressions of evil, celebrating the one whose resurrection is a sign of the destruction of all evil and who inspires actions of mercy and hope. Amen. Let us bring before God our troubles and hopes. Source of all love,
you created earth, sea, sky, and all their creatures.
You have commanded us to take care of them, and we have failed. You created humanity in your own image, and you commanded us to love one another, and we have failed. You have loved us, and you have commanded us to love you with our whole hearts, minds, and souls, and we have failed. Yet you love us. Forgive us, please. Help us to make right what we have done wrong. Give us the will and the way to follow you and to obey your commandments. Make us the people you want us to be. Amen. Beloved of God, hear this news. Christ is risen from the grave and sin no longer has any hold on you. In the name of Jesus, all of your sins are forgiven. Rejoice in this good news and make a new start today.
Amen.
Please remain standing for the gathering hymn. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth.
Lord be with you.
And also
with you. O God of glory, your Son Jesus Christ suffered for us and ascended to your right hand. Unite us with Christ and each other in suffering and in joy, that all the world may be drawn into your bountiful presence through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel, according to St. Luke, the 24th chapter. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written, that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." Then he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he was blessing them, he withdrew from them and was carried up into heaven. And they worshiped him, and they returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and they were continually in the temple, blessing God. This is the gospel of our Lord. In the first book, Theophilus, I wrote all about what Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up to heaven after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. While staying with them, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father. "This," he said, "is what you have heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now." So when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel?" He replied, "It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day journey away. When they had entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying, Peter and John, James and Andrew, and Peter and Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. All these were constantly devoting themselves to prayer, together with certain women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as his brothers. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
I would like to invite any children forward for the children's message. I need at least one. You can sit in the front row, or that's great too, whatever you want. All right, so when are you done with school? In 2 weeks? But then are you really done? Yeah. You really are? You're never going back? You, that's your wish? But what about in the fall? What grade will you go into in the fall?
Seventh.
You're going to go into seventh grade. All right, so then you'll start junior high. What happens when you're done with junior high? Then you're done again? Forever? You hope? You'll probably start high school. And then what happens when you graduate high school?
College.
All right. So when you're done with school, are you done learning, do you think, forever? No? All right, good. So learning doesn't stop when you finish school, right? We keep learning new things every day, even when we're not going to school anymore. How many of you have learned something new this week? See? Look around. Almost everybody raised their hand. When your parents had you, they promised to take care of you and make sure that you did things like go to school and that you would have all the things that you need to grow. And when you were baptized, or if you haven't been yet, when you are baptized, your parents, guardians, and this church come together and make promises to you and to God. We promise to bring you to church, to teach you to pray, to give you the words and the stories that we have in the Bible, and to try to help you understand it. We promise to help you work on figuring out your faith and to teach you all about living by Jesus' law of love, caring for and seeking justice and peace for everybody, right? The best promise ever, though, that is made in baptism is God's unbreakable promise to you that you will remain a child of God, a beloved, special, and wonderfully made child of God forever. Even if we mess up sometimes, or if we as a church aren't perfect about keeping all of those promises that we made at baptism, God's promise of love to you will never be broken. So today we're going to see three young women affirm their baptism. They have been attending classes, and hopefully they have learned something about who God is and maybe a little bit about who they are. And they're going to take on some of those promises that we made to them for themselves. Some people compare confirmation to graduation, and that's an okay comparison as long as you remember that just like we don't stop learning when we graduate high school or college, we don't stop growing in faith just because we're confirmed. We're still here as a church to help you grow, just like we're still here as a church to help all of us grown-ups grow, right? Because we're not done either. And we're going to do our best to help you keep those promises and for you and everyone we meet. Should we pray? Gracious God, thank you for your promise that you will love us forever. Help us to keep our promises to you and to each other. Help us to make sure that we share your love with everyone we meet, following the example of Jesus, and help our faith continue to grow. Amen. And go back to your job is done. Thank you. All right. So I did not write this sermon, and Anne and I did not talk about this together again. So just know that these are Anne's words, and I'm just reading them to you today. Grace and peace to you all. Today is the seventh and final Sunday of the Easter season. We began this year's celebration of the risen Christ on April 9th. And we have been singing and shouting our hallelujahs ever since. The white and the gold pyramids and vestments proclaim the glory of the risen Savior. The Paschal candle is lit every worship service during Easter. Gospel readings are focused on the presence of the risen Lord, first with Mary in the garden, and later with the disciples, minus Thomas, then with Thomas the questioner. And because this is the year of Luke's gospel, we have also walked with Cleopas and his companion along the road to Emmaus and share their joy in Christ as was revealed to them in the breaking of the bread. Next week, the white and the gold will be packed away. The sanctuary will be adorned in bright red, and the 50 days of the Easter season will be completed, and we will celebrate the high holy day of Pentecost, the birthday of the Christian church, when the Holy Spirit descends upon thousands of visitors in Jerusalem and creates faith that spreads like whirlwind and fire. Today is a transitional Sunday, a day in between Easter and Pentecost, a day when the risen Christ is still with the disciples on earth, and a day when he gives them final instructions to bid them farewell and ascends into heaven. You might have noticed that we switched up the order of the scriptures today. We read from Luke's gospel, and then we read from the book of Acts. Usually the gospel reading is the final reading, right? But today is a transitional Sunday. We read the very final words of Jesus to the disciples in the conclusion of Luke, and we proceed immediately to the beginning of Acts. As the story continues, we are transitioning between what some call the season of Jesus, where Christ is present on earth with his disciples, to the season of the church, after Jesus ascends into heaven and sends the Holy Spirit and establishes the one holy Catholic and apostolic church. At the very end of Luke's gospel, Jesus opens the disciples' eyes to the scriptures, and the message he shared with them was that the Messiah had to suffer and then rise from the dead on the third day. And he told them that repentance and the forgiveness of sins in Jesus' name was to be proclaimed everywhere. That's it. That's the mandate for the disciples. Simple enough, right? But they had questions. They had doubts. And after all they had been through, they wanted certainty to replace their doubts. And so in the beginning of Acts, they asked Jesus, "Lord, is this the time that you're going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" They not only wanted certainty, but they wanted the certainty that Jesus was going to restore earthly political power to their people. After all they had been through, after all they had heard, after Jesus had told them to go proclaim Christ crucified and risen, the disciples were still asking the wrong question. Jesus said to them, "It is not for you to know." And then he ascended into heaven. And they set their gaze up into the sky, and two men in dazzling apparel wondered why. And they reminded the disciples that Jesus had promised to come again, and just that as he ascended, so will he descend. For the rest of their lives, those disciples lived in a transitional time, a time between the first coming of Christ and his second coming. And so do we. Christ has died, Christ is risen, risen from the tomb, and risen into heaven, and Christ will come again. We live between Jesus' first coming and his second coming. We live between the book of Acts and the book of Revelation. And we are not alone. Jesus promised to the disciples an advocate, a comforter, a holy presence, the Holy Spirit, who came to the first believers just 10 days after the ascension on the day of Pentecost, and who has come to the church in every age, including us here today at Emmanuel Lutheran Church. Lutheran Christians believe and confess that the Holy Spirit comes to us in word and in sacraments of holy baptism and holy communion. We hear God's word each week. We receive Jesus's body and blood each week, and every once in a while, we celebrate a baptism. As you know, baptism is a gift from God, not a work that we can accomplish. Through the faith that receives baptism, we receive forgiveness of sins, life, and salvation. And the Holy Spirit works to create that faith within us. We are baptized only once, but we can affirm our baptism at any time. And today we will rejoice with three young women who will publicly affirm their baptismal faith that the church confesses. We can speak the affirmation of our own baptisms as well. Affirming our baptism is not a sign that we have all the answers. Some of you might remember a while ago, confirmation was an education program that included memorizing Martin Luther's Small Catechism, all five parts with all the answers verbatim, and you might have had to memorize it that way, did you? Yeah. Did any of you worry that if you didn't get those answers right, that they were going to say, "Nope, you can't be confirmed tomorrow"? There is great merit in knowing the catechism by heart. If you know the catechism by heart, then you may find comforting words welling up in your soul just when you need them. Martin Luther himself turned to portions of the catechism daily because he knew he needed daily reminders of the foundations of our faith. But memorizing the catechism doesn't make one worthy to affirm one's baptism. It isn't a matter of worthiness, is it? It is a spirit of a confessing faith that you have, that faith that the Holy Spirit has given you. Cora, in your faith statement, you mentioned doubts and questions. Annabelle, you confess that there is a lot about God that you don't know. And Peyton, you mentioned that you're unsure about what you can't see. Well done. You have learned the ways of humility, living with questions, and maybe sometimes hearing Jesus say, just as he did to those disciples, that there are some things that are not for you to know, at least not right now. I pray that the Spirit will bless you and all of us with an ongoing deep desire to continue questioning, to live in community with believers, sharing our questions and answers together, and to discover those answers, to discover together the answer to those knowable things that we have yet to discover about being followers of Jesus. Let us never be complacent. Promises were made on behalf of a community of faith when we were baptized. Today, you will claim those promises as your own. You will state your intention to turn away from sin, and you will state your faith in God, who is revealed to us as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And you will publicly confess not only those elements of your belief, but also the way you intend to live your lives. That is, you intend to continue to hear God's word, bringing it to both your doubts and questions, and that you intend to continue to receive God's gift of Holy Communion, and that you intend to serve all people in the name of Jesus Christ for his sake, loving God and loving your neighbor as yourself. That's a tall order. That's a lot of promises. But you're not alone. God the Holy Spirit dwells in you, and whatever God calls you to do, God will certainly equip you to do it. Amen. It's not usual that I would be doing all of this. I was waiting for Kirk to start the organ up. This morning, in honor of our confirmands, we're going to be singing for the hymn of the day, 10,000 Reasons, and I'm going to lead us, but please, 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 rise as you are able and sing with me. Thank you. Dear friends, we give thanks for the gift of baptism and for these people, one with us in the body of Christ, who are making public affirmation of their baptism. I present Annabelle, Cora, and Peyton, who desire to make public affirmation of their baptism. Would you please come forward? Just come stand here. Let us pray. Merciful God, we thank you for these sisters, whom you have made your own by water and the word in baptism. You have called them to yourself, enlightened them with the gifts of your Spirit, and nourished them in the community of faith. Uphold your servants in the gifts and promises of baptism, and unite the hearts of all whom you have brought to new birth. We ask this in the name of Christ.
Amen. Amen.
I ask you to profess your faith in Jesus Christ, reject sin, and confess the faith of the church. Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God? Do you renounce the powers of this world that rebel against God? Do you renounce the ways of sin that draw you from God? All right. Congregation. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
You have made public profession of your faith. Do you intend to continue living the covenant God made with you in holy baptism, to live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God and share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people, following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth? People of God, do you promise to support these sisters and pray for them in their life in Christ?
We do, and we ask God to help and guide us.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit you give us new birth, cleanse us from sin, and raise us to eternal life. All right, young ladies, you're going to take turns now. So, Annabelle, you're first. All right. Stir up in Annabelle the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen. Stir up in Cora the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever.
Amen.
Stir up in Peyton the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever.
Amen.
All right. Let us read. Oh, you read that.
Let us rejoice with these sisters in Christ. We rejoice with you in the life of baptism. Together we will give thanks and praise to God and proclaim the good news to all the world.
All right, and now. You guys may return to your seats. We're going to join in prayers of intercession.
United in the hope and joy of the resurrection, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Ever-present God, root your church firmly in you. Let us neither become entranced staring up into the heavens, nor distraught by the sufferings of the world. Teach us to see you in every face, every place, and every moment. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of the cosmos, you cradle creation in your loving arms. In the budding of flowers, greening of the fields, and the formations of land and sky, reveal your abundant life. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Eternal God, your reign is above us, around us, beneath us, and beside us. We pray for peace with justice in Sudan, Ukraine, Somalia, Senegal, Palestine, and Israel, and in all nations. We pray for refuge for millions who are displaced from their homes by violence or famine. Pour out your spirit upon those in authority, that they work for the well-being of those who suffer the most. Hear us, O God. God of companionship, provide clarity and direction for those experiencing life transitions in births and deaths, new employment and new relationships, graduations and retirements, divorces and departures. We pray for those who are sick. Hear us, O God. Eminent God, in you we live, move, and have our being. We pray for strong and compassionate communities that love, honor, and advocate for neighbors of all races, classes, gender identities, sexualities, ages, and abilities. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of welcome, you call us to feast at your eternal banquet. We give thanks for those who came before us, whose lives witnessed to your love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Rejoicing in the victory of Christ's resurrection, we lift our prayers and praise to you, Almighty and Eternal God. Through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
During this holy time of worship, you become a priest to your neighbor, blessing them with these words, God's peace be with you. Speak your priestly blessing with reverence and with full confidence that God uses you as a means of grace. You may also embody the blessing by bowing, nodding, or folding your hands together in a posture of prayer. As we begin our offering today, I invite you to enjoy the offering music presented by two of our confirmands. And normally I would say to come up and look at the artwork during communion, but feel free to come up and look at the artwork that was presented by another of our confirmands. Our confirmands' faith statements are in the insert in your bulletin, and I invite you to read them during offering today. O God of justice and love, we give thanks to you that you illumine our way through life with the words of your Son. Give us the light we need, awaken us to the needs of others, and at the end, bring all the world to your feast through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory forever. Amen. Gathered together by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. Your kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours.
The God of all who raised Jesus from the dead, bless you by the power of the Holy Spirit to live in the new creation. Amen.